Welcome to Kurt Landry Ministries.
Shabbat shalom. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise in the house tonight. It's going to be a wonderful, wonderful night. We've got several guests that are in the house tonight, and I'm going to introduce them here in just a little bit because several of them are not here. They're out looking at your immersion room. Taking a tour, but what I would like to do is let's go ahead and let's bring all the shofars down, and let's go ahead and start with our shofar blast. If you'd all please stand with us. Hallelujah. Can I have someone blow the house shofar? Riley? There you go. Did you all enjoy the feast this year?
Yeah.
Boy.
Yeah.
Very, I would say this was the most powerful feast time in the fall that we've ever had. And I'm believing that the spring feast will even be more powerful, and the fall after that, I think it's just going to keep increasing. Don't you think so? So we're going to go from faith to faith, glory to glory, and we're very, very excited about that. It's very quiet in Israel right now, and God's giving Israel really a time of rest. But one of the things we need to pray, particularly after Tabernacles, is we need to pray. There's a team here that's also going to Israel that I prayed for tonight. We need to agree that the rain comes. Because in Israel, you only get one little bit of season where you get a lot of rain, and this needs to come now. And so it needs to fill up the Kinneret, the Sea of Galilee, and the aquifers, and it's very, very important that we have rain, because it's not like here where if you don't have it there, you're in trouble. And living in the desert, you'll know that rain is very precious. Water is very precious. So we're going to pray for the peace of Jerusalem, and we're going to pray for that rain to fall. Amen?
Amen.
If you join me, Father God, in the name of Yeshua, we pray for the peace of Jerusalem and all of Israel. And Lord, your word says in Zechariah that those who keep tabernacles will have rain. And Lord, all of Israel has kept tabernacles. So in the name of Jesus, we call on the rain to fall. Exceedingly abundantly, in the natural and in the spirit, in Yeshua's name. Amen. Let's give a shout.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You know, we've been praying on the second shofar blast for the persecuted church. We started this, maybe 6 or 7 months ago. And it's amazing how the Lord wanted us to be ahead of that, because you can see the persecution now. ISIS is now declaring war on Christians. We're used to this as Jews. We're used to everyone wanting to declare war and hate us. And now you're seeing this where there's this organized terrorists are now targeting the church. And I want to tell you that that's a good thing. It's a good thing. The reason it's a good thing is because the enemy is finally starting to recognize, I'm speaking about Satan and the powers and principalities, that God is getting ready to empower the church. And the fact that the enemy is recognizing the church as a threat, I mean, everyone in the Middle East knows Israel's a threat. You realize that with nuclear subs and all the weapons, Israel could take out any one of its neighbors in about 10 minutes. And that's why they respect them. But now the Lord is starting to exalt the church and raise the church up. And these demons don't know it, but what's happening is they're learning the respect of the power of the name of Jesus. And God is going to keep the church in Iraq and in the areas of the Kurds and even in Syria. And God's going to do something supernatural. And you're going to see it between now and the end of the year. But we want to come in agreement with that. Father God, in the name of Yeshua, we lift up our brothers and sisters, the persecuted church, all over the world. Lord, raise them up. Signs and wonders, miracles. Put your angels around and about them for protection. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's give a shout. Hallelujah. I've been on the phone just this evening with Dr. Jay Swallow. He had to have surgery. He had part of his leg removed. But I want to tell you what I told him. I said, we've lost the battle, but we've won the war. Because the enemy's not afraid of his foot, he's afraid of his mouth. And if he wouldn't have given up his foot, he wouldn't have a mouth, because what was in his foot was going to take his life. And sometimes in the humbling of a servant of the Lord, and for all of us, there are times when we have to give up things that make no sense. And sometimes we actually lose battles. But if we understand that there's a higher calling, and that's winning the war, that God will use us in a very powerful way. And so I want this last shofar blast not only to be for Dr. Apostle Jay Swallow, but for the First Nations people, because I'm seeing a strength and a wisdom come into him, even while he's in the hospital, that there's a voice that's going to come out of Indian country. And I believe that this voice is going to rise up. And this is what Dr. Billy Graham said. There's a sleeping giant in the land, and that sleeping giant is waking up. And so I don't take this as a negative, but a positive, because he's very positive about it. It was difficult at first, but he realizes now his strength in his ministry is what he says more than how he looks. Amen. Because he has something to say to his people, and he is totally connected to Israel, and he loves God. And so would you pray with me? Father God, in the name of Yeshua, we lift up Dr. Swallow. We thank you for healing him, strengthening him, and in this time of rehabilitation, Lord, let the word of God for his people in this season be birthed in Yeshua's name. Let's give a shout. Hallelujah. Shofars, you may be dismissed. We're going to have Pastor Tim and Sandy come and light the Shabbat candles. How many of you are ready for Shabbat? Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand clap.
I don't know if you're like me, but it was just kind of like when I came in through the door, it's just like, whew, we made it. We made it. It is so good to come into the house of the Lord. This is what is called Simchat Torah, the rejoicing in the Torah,
That's rejoicing, right.
In the teaching. It's when the Word of God starts a whole new cycle of instruction. I don't think it's any accident tonight that we're here on Simchat Torah with the beginning of a new cycle, a new season of the revealing of the Word of God. So tonight, as we prepare to say the blessing, let the Sabbath rest. Everything that God has focused his attention to achieve in our lives is to bring us into that Sabbath rest, that peace of God that passes all understanding. Let that peace come into your heart. As we say the blessing in the Hebrew first, let the joy of the Lord flood your souls. Your mind, will, and emotion, being let all the anxieties go, stresses go, worries go. We're in the house of God. Isn't it good to be in the house of God? Let's say the blessing first in the Hebrew. Baruch Ata Adonai. Eloheinu Melech Haolam. Asher kidshenu b'mitzvotav. Vizavanu lehadlek ner shel Shabbat. Now in the English, blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who has sanctified us by your commandments and commanded us to kindle the lights of Shabbat. So Father, tonight we rejoice. We rejoice in the presence of the Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you have brought us at this season of time and in history, Lord, to come into a place that we can worship you in spirit and in truth with one voice, the one true God. Father, tonight we thank you in advance for the miracles that are begun to happen in this place because your presence is here. And Lord, we choose to allow you to have your complete freedom to do whatever you choose to do in this place. And Lord, we lay aside every thought of what should be or what could be, but Lord, we have an expectation of what you are and that you are bringing, Lord, the fulfillment of your promise into this place tonight in Yeshua's name. If your agreement, you would say, amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let's have the worship team come up. Megan, if you'd bring your worship team up. The thing I love about House of David is there's really no order of service, if you've noticed. And also, we never know who's going to come and visit us. We always have wonderful surprises from the nations. I did know this earlier this week, but we have one of my favorite pastors in all of Oklahoma. We have Pastor Carmen Gill. And give her a warm welcome. I'm going to have her speak a blessing out over you later in the service. But she has also brought, look at these beautiful dancers. And look at, I don't know how long yet. We didn't know you were coming, but we're glad that you're here. And I need to know this, is you can dance, but do you need fast and slow? Which one? Both? Okay. Where's Megan? Okay. Burnin' Me, which was your first song anyway, is perfectly. So if we would welcome the special dance team from Victory Hispanic Church in Tulsa. Come on up, guys, which I've been blessed to be the rabbi of that congregation for more years than I can remember, a long time. When Dr. Miller and I went to Nicaragua, this is what we found. This beautiful Latin people who love Israel, who have menorahs and stars of David and blow shofars and banners. What are they doing? Oh, they're going to have a... Oh, they're going to... Okay, well, let them have Paul find their music. But let them dance to this first song because they'll love this. Come on. Give them a warm welcome. One family? Wow. So they don't know what we're going to do. We don't know what we're going to do. But the Holy Spirit knows. And it's going to be glorious. Amen? So Gloria, Señor. Gloria, Señor Jesus Cristo. So, Father God, we ask that you come with power, that your glory ascend upon this place, that, Lord, that your names be lifted up high, that the power of God ascend and heal and deliver everyone here and those watching online, that, Father God, that you would bless us as we worship you as family, as mishpacha, familia, as mishpacha. We are the mishpacha of the Lord. We worship you in spirit and truth in Yeshua's name. Amen. Do you have any cough drops? I want you to receive those words. This is the Shemitah year. This is a time of rest. This is a time of recovery. This is a time where God redeems you. This is when God refreshes you. You get 12 months of refreshing, 12 months of blessings, 12 months of the joy of the Lord. So you're either going to magnify the Lord, or you're going to magnify Ebola. We cast that down. You are the redeemed of the Lord. No curse shall touch you. Ebola is a sickness. It's a curse. I don't care what name it is. Every knee must bow to the name of Yeshua. We are the redeemed and the healed of the Lord. Hallelujah. All things new. All things new. All things new. I just want you to receive that into your spirit. Look at all the different houses dancing together. This is what we're going to see in the New Jerusalem. This is a preview of a coming attraction. So let's worship the Lord. But when you're singing this next song and decreeing it out into the heavenlies, receive that. And whatever is old in you, let it go. Just let it go. You don't need it. It was yesterday's stuff. Your spiritual life is like your breath. Once you breathe that first one in, it's only good is to exhale it. Amen. Take a fresh breath. Receive a blessing tonight. Be set free tonight. All bitterness, all sickness, all disappointment. Say it's over. It's over. All things new. Ready? You be seated just for a minute. We're going to take this time to worship the Lord with our tithes and our offerings. If you're in the house, you can make your checks out to House of David. Online, you can give securely online to Kurt Landry Ministries. While you're getting your offerings ready, I want to give you a testimony. On Wednesday night, we celebrated the Feast of Tabernacles. And I was instructed that we had $110,000 needed to finish the inside of the sanctuary. So the Lord said, I want you to ask for that offering. And that night, in-house, exactly $110,000 came in. Come on, give the Lord a hand clap. I think the thing that was amazing, it wasn't 109. It wasn't 111. I know of one family, they called me and they said they brought in their tithe and their offering for the building. And then the Lord spoke to both the husband and wife. And they said, it's not enough. And they gave three times as much as they gave in the offering. And as I talked to him, I said, isn't that interesting? We would have been, I don't know what the numbers are. I don't look at that. But we would have been short that figure and wouldn't have. So when God has you decree a thing, you need to believe it. We want to thank all of you on the One New Man Network and all the partners of Kurt Landry Ministries because you have been so generous. So generous. And Christy and I and the staff here want to thank you. You just blow us away. You're so generous. Some of you may never be able to travel here, and here you are sowing seed into this embassy of the One New Man. We hope that you come, but you have been so extremely generous with us, and we thank you so much. And it looks like we're going to meet that date to be in the building under the date from the fire marshal. We still need help to finish the outside and some of our camera stuff, but we're so close, and I just want to give the Lord a hand clap because it's very powerful. As you stand and we prepare to bring our offerings forward, I'm going to ask Pastor Carmen Gill to come and speak a blessing over you. Now, she needs a new building. She has a 2,000 member church, and they have way outgrown their facility. And I know that she has found a new building. And if I'm not mistaken, it's $2 million. So as she stands here and blesses you with this mic in this house, Christy and I are going to lay hands on her shoulders. But I want you to touch and agree that as she blesses you, we're going to bless her, and this $2 million is going to come in. Would you say amen? Let's welcome Pastor Carmen Gill. Thank you.
Thank you. What an honor being here, and I think God has a purpose for everything. He divinely ordains our steps, so we know in God's timing we are in the right timing and in the right place tonight with the right people. I think God has those divine moments that we need to all appreciate. So we're going to bless that offering. Father, in the name of Jesus, I just thank you that that offering will be multiplied, Father. We are in the time of multiplication. And your word says that everything we touch, it will be blessed, Father. Therefore, we bless everything it's in their hands, that it will be multiplied. It will go forward, Father, and it'll come back to them. Multiply. They'll come back, Father, in healing, in restoration, in healing of marriages. We'll come back that seed that they're planting right now, Father. I thank you, it's supernatural seed that it's going forth, and it will come back, Father God, in complete restoration of businesses, of families, of marriages, of children. We call forth restoration and healing. Healing in their finances. Healing in their minds. Healing in their bodies. Healing in everything that they touch and everything it's around them, Father. We release your healing power in this house. And we thank you, Father God, for this place where there is an open heaven. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you so much. Let's give Pastor a hand clap. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You may be seated. Well, it seems like I was just here. All the way up here, flying up here with Pastor Caldwell. My wife gave me strict instructions. You believe for the airplane, for our ministry, so that we can quit having to make that 7-hour drive. So in Jesus' name, may stretch out your hands and believe for Rabbi and I. Hallelujah. Praise God. As a young man growing up in Central Arkansas, I used to say that I listened to Pastor Caldwell when I was just a boy. And he really chastised me. And he said, "Now, you weren't just a boy." No, I wasn't. I was a teenager, but the reason I think I was a boy is because when I was a boy, his Agape Church had a program on Saturdays called Kids Like You. It was this wonderful Christian-based, Christ-centered, a lot along the lines of Pastor Willie George, I'm sure, and what he did as Cowboy Bill, and I'm not saying you got that idea from him. He probably got it from you, but anyway, just it's a great program, and Agape Church was on one of the stations when I was a child. And then Pastor Caldwell launched out by faith, and that church did, to take the airwaves of Arkansas with VTN, Christian Television, across the state, and now covers almost all of Arkansas and portions of other states. And when I became Spirit-filled as a Baptist, I had to have someone. And he didn't even know he was doing this, but Pastor Happy Caldwell became my spiritual father and my apostle. He's not a man who likes titles. He's a very humble man. He's the greatest Bible teacher that I personally have ever sat under. And so tonight, I feel like I'm introducing my father because he indeed is my spiritual father. And the apostle of Arkansas who has taken the airwaves. And when the prophecy came, as goes Arkansas, so goes America. It could not be so without this man's faith of 35 years to take the airwaves first. Welcome my father, our apostle in Arkansas, Pastor Happy Caldwell.
Thank you.
Thank you, son. I appreciate that. You're a blessing. Shalom, y'all. Turn and tell somebody, I'm sure glad you came tonight. How many of you are here tonight? Good. I was telling Pastor Landry just a few moments ago, the anointing in the house, I was so blessed. I told him, I said, I haven't sensed this kind of anointing since the first trip I made to Israel. I was blessed to travel with Dr. Lester Sumrall 5 years. We did world leadership conferences in Jerusalem. And the first time that I went, of course, like all pilgrims, we went down to the Wailing Wall. Friday night, sundown, Shabbat, and the rabbinical students came out dancing down to the wall, prayed. So the next day, I went to pray the Wailing Wall. And the Lord spoke to me and said, I want you to put your hand on this wall. And of course, I, like many Gentile Christians, I've looked at that wall. People had cried on it, touched it, and it was dirty. And there's little prayer slips stuck in all the cracks. How many of you have been there? You know what I'm talking about. And so I didn't really want to touch the wall. And I said, Lord, I don't really. He said, I said, touch the wall. Yes, sir. And I laid my hand on that wall, and I literally experienced the power of God go into me. His power is still there. His anointing is still there. That time in Israel and many other times after that, I fell in love with the Jewish people. I fell in love with the land. If the Lord and my wife would agree, I'd move over there. I'd live there. I love it so much, and I love the people, and I love the nation. So I'm very honored to be here tonight and to be here with you. I've already enjoyed the worship. Pastor and Michelle Steele, pastor in Kansas City, or in DeSoto, Kansas. And this year, they said the Lord spoke to them to travel and meet us where we did meetings. Most of the time, the two of them come with my wife and I. They don't travel with us, but they meet us in the places to help us with our book table and traveling, etc. Michelle just finished recording some of her programs at our studio in Little Rock, and she was driving back home, so she brought our material. And we have some out in the foyer. I think some of it will be a blessing to you. And so I'd like for her to come at this time and introduce to you some of the products that we have back there on the table. Pastor Michelle.
Thank you. Praise the Lord. What an honor it is to be here. Praise the Lord. I am so excited about Pastor Caldwell's series on ownership. I want to share with you about some of the things that he brought with him from his media and product tables. The ownership is so important because the Lord spoke to Pastor Caldwell specifically for over 2 days. This kept resonating in his spirit. It's not about taking back what the devil has stolen. It's about ownership. And he set out on a course to find out details about what the Spirit of the Lord was speaking to him about ownership. And as he began teaching this in his church and sharing that information, the revelation of the Holy Spirit came out and in so many different aspects. And one of the most important, I think, is to recognize that in Jesus Christ, God is returning us. He has made us heirs of God and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. And so there's a lot of information in here. He shares how he was sitting with Dr. Jerry Savelle. They were actually on vacation. And he said, Jerry, if Adam hadn't have fallen, we would be able just to enjoy this vacation and we would just be able to live here in Hawaii all the time and not even have to preach. And the Spirit of the Lord spoke to him and said, that's not true. And he said, well, Lord, what would we preach if the man hadn't fallen? What would we preach? You know, we wouldn't need to preach redemption. We wouldn't need to preach salvation. He said, you would need to preach what Adam should have been preaching. And he said, Lord, what was Adam supposed to be preaching? Adam was supposed to be preaching dominion. And so that information is in here. I encourage you, you'll be blessed by the teaching on ownership. Amen? One of the landmark things that has helped so many people in the body of Christ is how Pastor Caldwell, after pastoring over 30 plus years in Little Rock, Arkansas, transitioned and brought in a new pastor in his church. And so many people are being helped all across the world to know how to make that transition. And the Spirit of the Lord spoke to him about transition, impartation, and manifestation. Every one of us have different aspects of transition that we need to go through, and we want to do it with the help of God, and we want to do it His way. And so this teaching is on transition and how that when we make that transition, if we'll allow the impartation of God, we'll have the manifestation of what His desire and His plan for us is. One of His most recent books that we have with us today is The Believer's Authority. And Whitaker House asked Pastor Caldwell to have this book about believer's authority. And he said, I recognize there are other people who have taught about the believer's authority and done a great job. And so, you know, but as I've read this book and as I've gone through this book, I recognize that Pastor Caldwell has brought out things from a pastor's perspective. There are details and there are different perceptions that a pastor will see to be able to teach us. And so this book on the believer's authority also has a Spirit-led study guide that goes with it. And I know you'll be empowered by that as well. And then a book that is a collaboration in this book called Faith, the Master Key to Life. And Rabbi mentioned that without faith, it is impossible to please God. This is a teaching that came from a faith conference at Agape Church. And the speakers of that conference were Jerry Savelle, Frederick Casey Price, Charles Capps, Keith Moore, and Pastor Caldwell. And their teachings and their revelation from that conference were all put into this book in one collaboration. And so it's a powerhouse book for sure. And then we also have a 4-CD series about great grace. And I don't want to go too far into that because I know that's Pastor's message today. But he discusses four different teachings in here discussing about the great grace that comes that came upon the early church, and God still plans for that great grace to operate in His church today. And so I know that we're going to be blessed by that message tonight, Pastor.
Thanks, Michelle. Also out on the table, there are some other books. My wife's book is out there. Called How I Learned to Trust God's Faithfulness. I can't quite get my wife to travel with me as much as she used to. She just likes to stay home more. But I did have them put together a video of her music. Three of her CDs are out there. And so I told her, I said, since you won't go with me anymore and you won't sing anymore, then I'm going to present this so people can be blessed. Many people have been healed while she sings, delivered. One lady in our congregation, she was blind, and on the way, and as Jeannie was singing, her eyes popped open. So she doesn't just sing to sing, she ministers. So if you all have that DVD up there, go ahead and play it at this time.
Her beautiful voice is unforgettable.
Thou art welcome in this place.
Her inspirational songs are timeless.
He's a healing Jesus. He's a healing Jesus.
For years, audiences have cherished the music of Jeannie Caldwell. From I'm a Believer,
yes, oh yes,
to The Anointing.
It's the anointing that really makes a difference.
Every song makes you feel in His presence.
Stand your ground against the devil. Stand your ground in the Lord.
Best loved hits, hidden classics. All found on Genie, Colors, and The Peaceable Kingdom. CDs you'll treasure forever. Buy yours today wherever the products of Happy and Genie Caldwell are sold.
I appreciate that. Turn in your Bibles with me to Acts chapter 4. We're going to begin reading with verse 32. We hear a lot of teaching today about grace. Most of it is very good. You know, you can take any truth and take it to an extreme and get into error. The Bible talks about grace. There is sufficient grace. There is abundant grace. And there is great grace. There is the Spirit of grace. You can do despite unto the Spirit of grace. Grace, very simply put, is God's willingness to use His power on our behalf, even though we didn't deserve it. Grace is like the legal side of redemption. Faith is like the vital side of redemption. We are saved through grace by faith. The legal side of redemption is what God has already done. The vital side of redemption is our part. The Bible says that we must enter into grace by faith. Faith is not nothing. Faith, by Bible definition, is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen yet. Excuse me. When we think of grace, we think of just unmerited favor. Thank you. Okay. But grace is much more than unmerited favor. Grace is God's willingness to use His power on our behalf. What if God had just said, well, you know, if you can do anything to save yourself, if you can do anything to get righteous, I'm all for it. We'd still be left in our sin consciousness. We'd still be left spiritually dead, separated from God. So God's grace is His willingness to use His power on our behalf, even though we didn't deserve it. Jesus became sin so we could become righteous. He made us righteous, not self-righteous. You've heard the scripture, our righteousness is as filthy rags. But it's not His righteousness that we're clothed with. I mean, it's not our righteousness that we're clothed with. It's His righteousness. He made us righteous. This is a hard thing for religious people to get hold of, to think that they've been made righteous. But your righteousness is not based on what you did. It's based on what Jesus did. It's based on what Jesus did on the cross for you. And your acceptance of what He did makes you righteous. Right with God through faith in Christ Jesus. We are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise because of Jesus Christ. Now, when we fully understand what grace is about, it takes the works out of it. You can't work to be saved. You can't work to be righteous. You can't work to get to heaven. Jesus did it all. He paid it all. Our faith in Him is what makes us righteous. And I've said this many times, if believers, if Christian people could get the revelation, the difference between the legal side of redemption and the vital side of redemption, they wouldn't be confused. A lot of them are trying to do what Jesus has already done. They're trying to get healed, trying to get healing, trying to get money, trying to get righteous, when healing has already been paid for. Righteousness has already been paid for. Your financial prosperity has already been paid for. The legal side is what God's already done. That's the grace side. He's already used His power on our behalf. The vital side is the faith side. The vital side is what you have to do using your faith. Now, in Acts chapter 4, the early church is experiencing something that is not experienced anywhere else in the Bible. Acts 4, verse 32. And the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and one soul. Neither said any of them that any of the things which he possessed was his own, but they had all things common. Now, this is not communal living. This is not socialism. This is not communism. These people had property they owned. I've heard ministers say and people say, well, you know, we don't own anything. It's all God's and we're just stewards. That's why I wrote that or taught that series on ownership. When the Lord said, it's not about running after Satan to get back what he's stolen. Now, you can do that because Proverbs 6 says, when you catch a thief, you make him pay seven times. But God was saying it's not about being on the defense. It's about being on the offense. It's not about just always running after the devil trying to get back what he's stolen. Keith Jackson, who was the tight end for the Green Bay Packers, Super Bowl champion. Big man. What do you, how, Priscilla, how big do you think he is? 6'4", 300 pounds. He and his wife are members of our church. And every year, Pastor's Appreciation Day, he'd come up and he'd hug me and lift me off the floor and give me an adjustment at the same time. Well, when we heard about all of this bullying going on in pro football, I asked Keith, I said, Keith, what do you think about that bullying? Do you remember seeing that? The pro football player that weighs 300 pounds and somebody was picking on him? Somebody was bullying him? And I asked Keith, what do you think about that? He said, give me a break. When the devil comes to bully you and comes to steal from you, it's not about just trying to get back what he's stolen. It's about ownership. It's about taking ownership of what God's given you. Now, here's the difference. I've heard people say this, and I've probably said it myself, and it sounds very humble. Well, it's not about us. It's not about us. It's not about us. So one day I went to the Lord and I said, Lord, there's something not right about that. What's going on? He said, son, if you'll read Ephesians, the first chapter, maybe half dozen verses, you'll see that everything I did was about you. He blessed us. He predestined us. He lifted us. He made us to sit together in heavenly places. He said, everything I did was for you. It is about you, but what it's not about is self. You see the difference? It is about us. It's just not about self. We're to be Christ-centered, not self-centered. We're not to be preoccupied with self. I have a life-size picture of Jesus. It was given to us by two brothers who rescued some Peruvian art that was hidden from the 15th century. And they reframed it, and they gave it to us as a gift. And I have it in my study, in my office, and I have a prayer bench under it. And I was praying one day, and I was praying and getting a revelation more and more of my identification with Christ. And all of a sudden, that revelation that I was cultivating in my mind and my thinking and muttering and musing and went into my heart. And all of a sudden, I realized I have no identity of my own. In Christ, I live and move and have my being. Oh, yes, I'm Jeannie's husband. I'm Ronnie's father. I'm my grandkids' grandfather, my great-grandkids' great-grandfather. But in Christ, I have no identity of my own. Paul said, I was crucified with him, yet I live. But not I, but he is living through me. This is an area that we're all working towards. John the Baptist said, I must decrease so he can increase. I want to get to the point where it's not me living, but it's Jesus living. And we say these things and do these things out of religion and out of false humility and so forth. But when we really find out what God thinks about us, you'd be amazed what God thinks about you. He says in Jeremiah what he thinks about you. He said, I think thoughts of peace about you, not evil, to give you an unexpected end, to give you a reward, to give you blessing. Amen. He loves you. You're his child. He wants to bless you. So the legal side of redemption is the grace side. It's what God's already done. The vital side is the faith side. It's what we have to use. And we're to take ownership. We're to take dominion. And the difference between being an owner and a son and a steward and a servant, an owner and a son is who you are. Stewardship is what you do. Service is what you do. You are not stewards and servants by nature. You're owners and sons by nature. Paul said, I call you no longer servants, but sons. The story of the prodigal son, even though the word prodigal is not in the scriptures, it's a good example. Both boys had no identity whatsoever that they were sons. Remember what the one boy said, the prodigal? He said, I'm going to go home, and my father's servants have it better than me. I'm going to go home and tell my daddy, Daddy, I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Just make me a servant. The father never answered him. He couldn't make him a servant because he was a son. If you'll separate who you are from what you do, it'll help you. You're a son by nature. You're an owner by nature, joint heir, joint ownership privilege through Christ. Now, what you do is you're a good steward of what you own, and you serve because you're a son. Now, let's go back here to the scriptures, because all these people that were at this particular time, none of them said any of the things which he possessed was his own, but they had all things common. Again, not a commune, not socialism, not communism. Let me try see if I can explain this to you, and then we'll come back and finish the rest of the passage. There were two things going on at the time that this great grace that we're going to read about was manifested. Number one, the people had one heart and one soul. They were in one accord. They had unity of purpose. Do you know why you are in this house of David? Do you know why God set you in this house? The Bible says that God sets the members in the body as it pleases him, not as it pleases you. I've had people in my congregation that have told me, this is over a 35-year period, different ones come and go, well, I'm coming to this church, but I don't want to be here. And I thought, wow. And then there are still people in our church today that were there the first day the door opened. They've been there 35 years. God set them there. And everything that God told us to do, they were part of that vision. So if you're here by divine order, then you fit in this category here. These people had a unity of purpose. They were one heart and one soul. They were one. Did you know that that's what happens in a marriage? Two become one. Amen. Oh, they're different people in their character, their personality, likes, dislikes, whatever, but they're one. God has joined them together. They become one. When you come into the house of David, when you come into this place and you're set in here by God, you become one with the pastor and his wife and the vision of the house. It becomes your vision. It becomes your vision just as much as it is their vision. So that's what was going on. The people had one heart, one soul. They were in one accord. They had unity of purpose. The apostles, now this is the second thing that was going on. The apostles were giving witness of the resurrected power of God. There were signs, wonders, miracles, gifts of the Holy Ghost. There were demonstrations of the Spirit that were going on. Now look what happened as a result of these two things in harmony. They were one heart, one soul. Nobody said, anything that I have is mine and you can't have it. They said just the opposite. They said, what I have, what I own, if you have need of anything, it's yours. And with great power, verse 33, gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. I want you to say this out loud. Great grace was upon them all. Now, this is not sufficient grace. Remember, Paul was facing some difficulties and he went to the Lord and the Lord said, Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. It'll get you through what you're going through. Then there was another place where there was abundance of grace. That means there's enough for you and for somebody else. But here, he's talking about great grace. If we want great grace, God's willingness to use His power on our behalf to a level we've never experienced before, we have to meet these two conditions. One heart, one soul, unity of purpose. Number two, the apostles have to give witness of the resurrected power of God. There has to be signs, wonders, miracles, and gifts of the Holy Ghost. There wasn't anybody in this group that lacked anything. Think of it. There was no need. There was nothing in the entire congregation here that anybody lacked. Not one thing. Did you know that property is the most tenacious of institutions? That's why lawyers are necessary to settle property disputes. Even in the church, we have what is called intellectual property rights. You can actually own your own sermon. You can get all of the residuals and royalties off of it. Because it came out of you, you own it. Intellectual property rights. But you have to have an attorney to write that up, and it has to be enforced. Well, in 1 Timothy 6, 17 through 19, it tells those that are rich in this world to be willing to share. It brings about the abolition of property. Yes, you own it. I've heard preachers tell me, I've had preachers tell me, well, you don't own anything. It all belongs to God. And I asked them, I said, do you own your Bible? Yeah. Do you own the clothes you got on? Yeah. You own your car? You own your house? You own the property? Yeah. Well, then you do own something. God originated it all. He created it all. But he gave it to you. Deuteronomy 8:18 says he gives you the power to get wealth. Jesus told his disciples in Luke 10, he said, you have been given the power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. Do you remember the storm that Jesus stopped on the Sea of Galilee and a storm rose up? I've been on it many times and the storm can come up real quick. And they were afraid for their lives. Do you remember that? And they went and woke Jesus up. He was asleep in the bow of the boat in a storm. Now, I can identify with that. I spent 6 years in the Navy, 2 years at sea on two different ships, and we rode out a hurricane one time. Now, when you're 20 years old and you have no sense and you're stupid, you're not afraid of anything. So, you know, we were confined to below decks, and we had these straps that fit across our legs and across our chest to hold us in our canvas rack so it wouldn't throw us out on the deck. I wanted to see the hurricane. So I unfastened and I ran up topside and lashed a broom handle across the bosun's locker. I was a bosun's mate, and I watched that hurricane. I was hollering and screaming and, you know, whoa! I mean, the waves were 30 feet high. The radio antennas are slapping the water. I mean, it was a ride. It was really something. I was having fun. Well, we would sleep through those things. Eventually, you get used to the sea and, you know, nothing bothers you. Jesus was asleep in the bow of the boat. They woke him up. Said, Master, don't you care? We're dying here. Jesus spoke to the wind, to the waves. He said, Peace, be still. The wind calmed down. The waves calmed down. Turned around to the disciples and said, Why didn't you use your faith? In other words, why didn't you take care of the storm? Why didn't you speak to it? Now, Rick Renner is a Greek scholar, pastors in Moscow, Russia. And he said what Jesus actually did, if you wanted to act it out, when he stood up, he as much as said to the wind and the sea, shh. Everybody do that together. Shh. Has a calming effect, doesn't it? That's what mamas say to babies. Shh. You see, what Jesus was actually doing was saying to the wind and the sea, stop that. Go back to the normal process for which you were created, which is not destruction. What does that tell you about tornadoes and hurricanes and earthquakes? They're perversions. They're driven by demon spirits. It's not God using them to teach us a lesson. You know, I hear people all the time say, well, I heard one preacher say on television, he said, now there's a hurricane coming to the East Coast. He said, and God's fed up with the sin on the East Coast, and so he sent this hurricane. Now let's pray. That's what he said. So I listened to see what he prayed. It's kind of stupid to pray against God sending a hurricane if you believe he's sending it. And what did the disciples say when Jesus rebuked the wind and the waves and said, why didn't you use your faith? They looked at him and they said, what manner of man is this? He's the God-man. He's the example. Ephesians 5:21 says, be ye therefore followers of God as dear children. So we're to imitate our Father. Did you know that children always imitate their fathers? Good, bad, or not, they imitate the Father. Fathers wonder sometimes, I wonder how my kid got so rebellious. Look in the mirror, Dad. He learned it at home. She learned it at home. So Jesus examples for us, and other scriptures example for us, that we have been given power. We've been given authority. Now keep reading with me down to verse 34, Acts 4:34. Neither was there any among them that lacked, for as many as were possessors of lands and houses sold them and brought the prices of the things that were sold. Did they own these houses and lands? If they didn't own them, they couldn't have sold them, but that'd be fraud. You can't sell something you don't own. So they owned them. And they sold them. And they brought the money and laid it down, verse 35, at the apostles' feet, and distribution was made to every man according as he had need. Can you imagine a congregation where there's no lack, there's no need, because anytime anybody has a need, it's met by the congregation? Now, I've seen this happen. In our church, when we first started, we were believing to build our new facility that we've been in for over 30 years now. The Lord had showed us 12 acres of land up on a hill, and He wanted us on top. Pastor Landry and Christy, Dr. Miller, you all have been there. And it's up on a hill. And before we got the parking lot paved and the driveways paved, when it rained, it was a mud hole. Gravel, mud. The ladies who would come to church would wear their tennis shoes to walk up the hill. And then they'd take their tennis shoes off and leave them in the hall and put on their high heels. The Lord told us to build it and pay for it as we went, which is what we did. There was a banker that he was willing to loan us the money. But the Lord said, no, I don't want you to borrow the money. I want you to build it and pay for it as you go. Because if you can't build a building, you can't reach a city. And if you can't reach a city, I have to get somebody else. Everything's relevant. When the Lord tried to get me to, excuse me, Lord. When the Lord tried to get me to be delivered from a poverty mindset, He told me that I had to pay full price for a suit of clothes. And I thought that was pretty ridiculous. Why have to pay full price for a suit of clothes? In those days, in the early 70s, I could buy three double knit suits for $100. He said, I want you to go find the most expensive suit in the department store and pay full price for it. Well, the most expensive suit I could find was a Hart, Schaffner, and Marx, three Hebrew children. And I would pay $350 for this suit. I could buy five suits for that. Why pay $350 for one suit? He said, if you can't pay full price for a suit, you can't build a building. And if you can't build a building, you can't take a city. He said, and while I'm at it, when you go to the restaurant, I want you to quit shopping down the right-hand side of the menu and shop down the left side of the menu. Oh, the right side is where the price is. He said, when you go to the restaurant to eat, you always buy the cheapest price. You don't even look at the food. You look at the price. He said, I want you to stop doing that. This was hard for me, because I was raised with a poverty mindset. It's the way I was raised. It was my father and his father before him. And, you know, my father was of the greatest generation. They went through the Great Depression, fought in World War II, came home, rebuilt America. And, well, you know, everybody saved everything. They didn't throw anything away. My grandfather had the whole side of his garage papered with the license plates off of every car he'd ever owned. He kept the sawdust that he would cut. He made his own furniture. He'd cut the sawdust on the floor. He'd scrape it up, put it in a jar. And I'd say, why do you keep the sawdust? He said, you never know when you might need some sawdust. So when you're raised like that, if I'm stepping on your toes, just lift them up off the floor a little bit, because It's going to get worse or better, however you look at it. So God was trying to teach me and train me, because what he wanted to do through me, he couldn't do with me having this poverty mindset. So I began to learn, and I found a suit, $350. I bought it. I don't know how I bought it, but I did. And I began to see what God was trying to get me to do. Okay, we're building our church. In the beginning, it looked a lot like what you're building next door. We'd finish a part of it, and the steel was sticking out, and then we'd finish another part of it, and we'd keep on going. We asked everybody in our church to believe God for $1,000. And when we finally got it built and moved in, we had built it. It's 43,000 square feet under roof, three levels. And we had built it for $12 a square foot. That's almost unheard of, unbelievable. Of course, that was 30 years ago, too. You know what the interest rates, if you borrow money to build a building from a bank, you know what the interest rates were in 80, 81, 82? 18%. God knows what, God's a good businessman. He knows what he's doing. And he said, I don't want you to borrow the money. I want you to build it and pay for it as you went. So we finally did it, got it finished. But we had a valuable learning lesson. Everybody in the congregation believed God for $1,000. Some of them got extra jobs. One couple painted their neighbor's house. They paid him $1,000. One man got a paper route. Got up every morning, 4 or 5 o'clock, and threw papers. Others knew certain things they were supposed to do. Seed, sowing, blessing, believing. Everybody did what they knew to do, what they could do. And one Sunday morning I noticed as we were in praise and worship, there was a family over here, and it was a mother and two daughters and one son. And they were standing over here, and there was no father in this family. It was a single mom and three kids. And I knew that they didn't have $1,000, and they were lifting up their hands and worshiping God. And I watched this gentleman in the back of the church back there. I knew who he was. He was a businessman. He was an investment banker. And I saw him looking, watching like this. Now, he had come to church for the sole purpose of meeting somebody's need. And while we were praising the Lord and worshiping God, she had her hands up. I saw him back there in the back writing out a check. And during the praise and worship, he walked down the aisle and stuck that check right into her fingers like this and walked back, and she never saw who it was. She just kept worshiping the Lord. She knew something was there, and she went like this, but she just kept worshiping the Lord. When she got through, she opened that check up, and it was for $1,000. He had come to church for the sole purpose of meeting somebody's need. And I found out later, he did that many times. That was what he enjoyed doing. That's what was going on here in the book of Acts. These people had one heart, one soul. When one of them had need, somebody else would meet it. When we got in our church, and it wasn't finished yet, it was still in process, but we were in it. There was an elderly lady that raised her hand one Sunday morning. I recognized her, and she said, Pastor, can I say something? I said, yes, ma'am. Now I knew who she was. I trusted her. She stepped out of the pew, and she came down the aisle pulling a pillowcase full of change. We found out later it was full of quarters, nickels, dimes, pennies. And it was so big, she couldn't lift it. An usher had to help her pull it down the aisle. And she brought it down here and she said, here's part of my $1,000. It was $600 worth of coins in that pillowcase. And she said, I have a word for this congregation. Can I give it? I said, help yourself. She said, I asked the Lord, like all of you, where am I going to get my $1,000? I don't have $1,000, Lord. How can I give $1,000? The Lord said, you've got more than you think. She said, where? The Lord said, you've been taking the change out of your husband's pants pockets for years. The Lord knows what you're doing. He said, go get all that change. She got all that change, put it in that pillowcase, and brought it down to the front. Now, here's the word she had for the church. And I was sure glad that the Lord asked her to say this and not me. She said, okay, how many of you believe in God for your $1,000? Well, most of them raised their hand. She said, the Lord showed me something to do, and if you all will give me your attention, I'll do it. She said, I want somebody to come down here and stand right here to represent what we all think of as poverty level. Now, this was hard for her and for the people. She said, I want somebody else to come down, stand right here in the middle that represents average income. And then I want somebody to come stand over here that's wealthy. And you can write a check for $1,000 and you'll never even miss it. Come. Well, it got kind of quiet there for a little while, but directly here comes a lady. She comes down and stands right here to represent poverty level. Then another young man comes down here to represent average income. And then another man comes and stands here and represents wealthy. She said, now here's what the Lord told me to tell you. You people over here, pointing to the poverty level, have wanted these people over here, pointing to the wealthy people, to build your church for you. She said, and they're not going to do it. And then she said, thank you, Pastor. And she sat down. And I said, well, I'm sure glad that was you, sweetheart. I'm glad the Lord spoke to you to do that. These people owned houses and lands. And it said that they laid their sale of their houses and lands at the feet of the apostles. A willingness to share is the last test of love. When the pain of selfishness ceases, the triumph of love is complete. You've always heard, give till it hurts? No. When the hurt leaves, you've now passed over into the complete, mature nature of love. Laying their property, the funds and the money at the apostles' feet was evidence that love had conquered their heart. Love of money was swallowed up in the love of Christ. When you and I become of one heart and one soul and have all things common, when one member of the body hurts, you hurt. One member of the body of Christ has a need, you have a need. I go to the grocery store and I look for people to buy their groceries. I remember one day I was at the grocery store and this lady in front of me in the checkout line, none of her credit cards would work. And she was getting frustrated. She had a baby in the basket and the baby was hollering and crying and the clerk was upset. The lady was upset. I thought, here's a good opportunity. I said, ma'am, let me buy your groceries. I'm just looking for somebody to bless today. I gave the clerk my credit card. I said, here, put all of her groceries on my credit card. Well, I was expecting her to just break down in tears and just say, oh, thank you, Jesus, hallelujah. You know what she did? She, as we say in Arkansas, she jump-straddled me. You know what that means? No, you are not going to buy my groceries. How absurd. I wouldn't hear of such a thing. She wouldn't let me buy them. She ran out to her car and found some more credit cards. Left that baby there, left the cart there, everything. She would not let me bless her. Another time, there was an elderly gentleman, and I had seen him at the grocery store several times. He and I shopped about the same time. And he watches us on television. See, when you're on television, everybody that sees you, that knows you, doesn't tell you they watch you. So you have to be nice all the time. Did you hear that, Pastor Miller? So one day he was behind me in the line. And I knew he was elderly, and I knew he was sickly, and I knew he was living on a fixed income, and I knew he was all the things about him. So I bought his groceries. Well, he let me do it. Some people don't know how to receive. I know the first time that ever happened to us, Jeannie and I had just resigned our jobs, just gone full-time in the ministry, and it was a Wednesday. And we had no money to buy groceries. Family of three, we're sitting there in the house praying. And all of a sudden, there's a knock on the door. Went to the door. There was a lady standing there. And this was before the days of cell phones. This lady said, my husband's a traveling salesman. He was traveling on the road in South Arkansas. He stopped at a payphone and called me and said, the Lord told me the Caldwell family needs $50 and they need it today. Go take it to them. So she went and got $50 and brought it to us. In those days, $50 is buy 5 sacks of groceries. We thanked her. She shut the door and she drove off. I was absolutely beside myself. I was so excited, so thankful, so appreciative. I was just, because God knew where I lived. That was a revelation. I turned to my wife, and she was absolutely disgusted. I said, honey, what is the matter with you? She said, this is not faith, this is charity. I said, I don't care what it was, this was $50 and we can go buy groceries. I don't care whether you call it charity or faith or what. But now here's the difference between her and me at that time. She said, well, okay, the first thing we're going to do then is give the tithe. I said, the tithe? She said, yes, the tithe, $5. I said, do we have to do it now? We hadn't had this money long. Can we wait a little while? See, she knew how to give. I knew how to receive. Now, I had to learn how to give, and she had to learn how to receive. Are y'all getting anything out of this? When the revelation of acquiring wealth is the power for social good, it will be evidence of a new stirring of divine love and great grace will be upon us all. You know, there's a difference between prosperity and wealth. Did you know that? Anybody can prosper. All you have to do to prosper is buy wholesale and sell retail. I mean, buy wholesale and sell retail. Right? But now wealth is different. when you transition from prosperity to wealth, your whole purpose changes. You are now prospering for social good, not yourself. You're prospering to produce. Your prosperity is for the power of social good. It's to impact your community. It's to impact your family. When you prosper for wealth, it's for succeeding generations. Good man leaves an inheritance for his children's children. When they have your funeral, the church, you're laying in the coffin, everybody's crying, expressing their tears. And then everybody walks out, and your grandchildren and your great-grandchildren walk over and say, "Praise God, what did Granddaddy leave you?" Or you can do like Brother Summerall did. He gave all of his to his sons before he died. Called them all in the living room, handed them all three a check. Said, "Here it is, boys. That's all there is. When I die, there'll be nothing. Enjoy it now." My wife and I are doing that now because we want to see our children and our grandchildren enjoy. After you're gone, you're not going to see them enjoy any of it. Yeah. Thank you for those few little grunts. All the kids say, "Hallelujah, amen, glory to God." So the acquiring of wealth is the power for social good. It's the evidence of a new stirring of divine love. Now I'm going to close with this. Great grace is the measure of divine favor upon the early church. The secret of spiritual power and prosperity. So when there's great grace, everybody benefits from it. Great grace is not just for you. Great grace is for everyone, not only this church body, but the community. Now I want to pray for you. Father, I thank you for your anointing on this congregation. I thank you for Sahete Mamala Kasale Pekishi. Oh Rabandi Kisele Pepele Kikili Babele Koko. I thank you for your anointing on Rabbi and his wife. Kohoshi Meesika Ala Mahoho Kiki Mamalako Shike Hasaka Talala Makale Hikekele Mololo Koko. Endomoko Setele Papa. Thank you for your anointing, Father. Porikese ekapo oshike, wisdom, insight, ideas. Aremeke kesi kapolo koshele papalakata. Thank you, Lord. Everybody just lift up your hands and begin to praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Poko sele bikia sele papalakata. Father, I thank you for great grace on this congregation. Father, they already have of your spirit. They already have of your anointing. They already have of your praise and your worship. They already have a measure. But I'm asking you for great grace. Great grace on the ministry of music. The minstrels, the psalmist. Great grace on the ministry of helps. Great grace on the praise team, the dance team. Great grace. Oh, sakapa shikele pepele koko. Sakapate. Great grace on that building being built next door. Great grace. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Let's everybody stand now. And if you can, grab hands with somebody. Everybody connected together. Thank you, Father. The keyboards. Somebody on the keyboards. On the keyboard. Piano. Now, I want you to just close your eyes. And I want you to just know that we are all joined together by that which every joint supplies. Thank you, Father, that you're building a house here. And you're setting people in this house as it pleases you. And I pray for great grace. One heart, one soul, unity of purpose. Pastor's heart becomes your heart. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Who's the mother over here? You. Are all these your children? Okay. Who's the oldest? The oldest. You've got all girls? There's another one back there. What about the little boys? Okay. Are you married? Do you want to be married one day? How old are you now? 16. The Lord quickened me to say something to you. Is that all right? Father, now, you're going to have a husband that loves you. You're going to have a marriage that is going to, people are going to envy your marriage. But you wait for him. You wait for that right man to come. You'll know. And the Lord would say to you, he's very pleased with you. You've been an example. And he's going to send a young man to your life. And you'll have a blessed marriage, a happy marriage, happy children. And God will be glorified in this. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. What's your name? Yamara? Thank you, Father, for your anointing on Yamara. What does that mean? Mama, what does Yamara mean? In the ministry. Hallelujah. Now, y'all don't be jealous of her. But you watch out for her. You see some guy hanging around that's no good, you run him off. Because she got to wait for the right one. You'll see to that, huh, Pastor? Hallelujah. Well, lift up your hands together and say, thank you, Father, for great grace. I receive great grace upon myself, my family, my church family, my house. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Now give him a shout. Praise God.
Timely, Pastor. We officially receive, after 16 years, great grace into the house of David. We receive it. If your team would get ready, we're going to go out in the dance. If someone would move the basket so they don't trip. While they're lining up and they're getting ready with the music, I want you to sit down for a minute. Yesterday we kind of had a, it felt like a funeral. Kevin McAbee and Miles came from Veritas Films. And we went out to Pastor Tim and Sandy's, and we filmed and we retold the story how House of David started with 8 people in the farm. And it kind of felt like a funeral for me because, you know how when you go to a funeral and they'll show the slides and the music and you say things like, gosh, I wish I would have spent more time with that person. You know, when I had that person, I wished I would have done this. And I know at my dad's funeral, different people got up and spoke, and I thought, I never knew that about my dad. And that's what happened yesterday, all day yesterday, as they were filming Little House of David, 8 people, and all these stories. And I watched Kevin McAfee, the producer, say, this only could have been God, because it's so miraculous what God has done. I want to tell you, Pastor Caldwell, I'm so blessed. And I know that if T.L. Osborne was here, he'd be so blessed that you would carry and release great grace. I know what great grace is. We weren't ready for great grace when T.L. was here. But we're ready for it now. May the mantle of great grace rest upon us. Because we are very, very thankful. And we do want to bless the community. We want to bless the nations. And we want to be a blessing to everyone that touches House of David. We want them to experience great grace. Amen. Praise God. Well, let's start the music. Thank the Lord. I want to give you an opportunity to sow into the servant of the Lord. You can make your checks out to House of David, and 100% of what you will give will go to Pastor Caldwell. I want you to sow into great grace. While I was talking about taking care of the community, I know that Jennifer Olson is now, are you the new director of? Are you on the board? January 1st. I used to be on the board, and I'm totally spacing out, so tell me, the Dexan? What Dexan is in the community is a ministry that when children are misused, they can go to Dexan and they give their testimony one time, and they record it with licensed physicians, licensed individuals. Because the way it works is the child, in normal systems, without that, they have to keep telling the story over and over. And every time they tell the story, it's like they're going through it again. With Dexan, they tell it once. It's in Delaware County. And I just want you to know that House of David will sponsor a table. And then if you want to go to the banquet, Christy and I won't be able to go, but House of David people, you just need to go and support the ministry. We'll pay for the table. You just need to fill it. Okay? When your people get involved in things, you need to support it. It was very humbling to hear some of the testimonies of the people talking about House of David and what God has done over the last 16 years. But I believe the best is yet to come because of what was released tonight. You understand that when a man of God comes carrying a message, you have to receive it. Sometimes people say, I have a hard time. No, I have no problem receiving great grace. I have no problem receiving wealth, because when I see something like this, without thinking about it, I can say we're doing it. I've been to Pastor Caldwell's church and studio. We filmed there many, many times. It's a great encouragement to Dr. Miller and myself to know that it was built by faith, like this house. This house is being, you need to know there's another generation doing it the same way. It's amazing. May we all be out of debt by the end of this year. All of us. May we say next year in Jerusalem, have a major party. And I'm believing for the $2 million for Pastor Carmen's building. And it means a lot to me that you and Lydia and the team would come. You're a great bridge builder, and we thank you for that. So if you'd stand. Father God, I just speak a blessing over this gift. And Lord, we understand the importance of sowing into an anointing. We're well taught here. We understand that principle. But Lord, let the love of God and great grace flow through us as we come into this new biblical year, 5775, the year of favor and grace, that we walk generous and at peace and free with each other, and most of all with God. Amen. Well, let's give Pastor Caldwell a hand clap. That was a wonderful message. Give Dr. Miller a hand clap. Thank you. Thank you for bringing him up here. Did you have something? You're good? I'm going to have Pastor Tim come and close this out. Would you just seal it? And I'm going to have you just bring your gift forward here. As soon as the pastor seals this, hug somebody's neck. And for all of you online, thank you so much. If you want to give online to Pastor Caldwell's ministry, you can give on CLM, designate it, and we'll pass your gift through. Receive the blessing. Shabbat shalom. And so good to see you all. And may great grace be released through the One New Man Network in Yeshua's mighty name. Pastor.
Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we seal this word. the grace that has been sown into us. Father, we receive it tonight, and we seal it by the power of the Holy Spirit. May the name of man be brought low, but the name of Yeshua exalted on high. If you're in agreement, you would say, amen.
Amen. Amen. Make sure you go by the product table and invest in your spiritual walk with the Lord. God bless you.